Function means positive contribution. Functional perspective constitutes a way of thinking about society, looking at the society, observing the society by highlighting the positive contributions of different elements of the society. All of you are clear to me, all are getting me properly or not? Is the thing clear to you or not? So write it down in single sentence. Functional perspective constitutes a way of analyzing different social phenomena different social phenomena by highlighting their positive contribution Got it or not? So I am explaining you. There are n number of elements in society. For example, education system is there, coaching class is there, police is there, judiciary system is there. Lots of things are there. So functional perspective will highlight the positive contributions of all these elements. For example, police is there. Generally, most of the people in society don't have a good view with respect to police. Yes or no? Most of the people don't have. But if you develop a positive view with respect to police institution, if you say police is a mechanism of maintaining law and order in society, your view is positive view, you are a functionalist. Some people believe. Theoretically, we believe police is given the responsibility of maintaining law and order. Okay or not? So while somebody is using power, there is maximum possibility of abusing power, misusing power, grossly abusing power, blatantly misusing power. Yes or no? Related to corruption, question may be asked. That I would discuss in separate class. Today, it's not possible to make a discussion. Long ago, there was a great administrator. Without qualifying Indian civil service, he became administrator. His name is Kautilya, Chandragupta Maurya's period. Kautilya wrote something related to corruption. He said, just like it is not impossible for a fish to drink water while it is swimming water, exactly in the same way, any public official discharging public duty may also grossly abuse his power. Getting my point? So generally, theoretically, we are told that police is a mechanism of maintaining law and order. So if you think like this, analyze like this, your view is a positive view. So you are a functionalist. So I am telling you the fact. Functional perspective is a way of analyzing a particular event of society by highlighting its positive contribution. So functional perspective would say police is maintaining law and order in a society. Had there not been police institution, anarchy, anomaly, indecision, chaos, confusion would have been prevailed in social life. Got it? This is the positive contribution of police. It has also negative contribution. But this is the positive contribution. Everybody would agree with me. Theoretically, police has enormous positive contribution. Then take another example, religion. Religion. You know religion. In some other class, I would make detailed discussion related to religion. So you know what religion is. What is religion? A set of beliefs, ideas, practices related to God, related to supernatural entity, related to morality in society, that is called religion. So, how functional perspective will analyze religion? functional perspective would say religion has enormous positive contribution for society. What is that? For example, there is an extraordinarily gifted student who stood first class fast throughout his career, took IAS examination, could not crack it, could not become successful. He believes in God, believes in religion. Suppose he is a Hindu. After failure in exam, he will feel frustrated, demotivated, discouraged, disheartened, dejected, yes or no? So, while a talented person fails and all the four attempts are gone, he could not make it. He may feel highly demotivated, he may feel frustrated, depression may come to his mind, and you know the result of depression, a depressed person, if counseling is not done to him, he may or she may commit suicide. So I am telling you, positive contribution of religion. Suppose the candidate, in spite of having gifted potential and talent, could not succeed, all the four attempts are gone. Right now he entered into depression, but he believes in God and religion. Right now he is in utter state of frustration, but he believes in God. He is a Hindu, has read Srimad Bhagavad Gita probably. There it's written, karmena badhika raste ma phalesu kadachana, in Sanskrit. I'm translating it into English. Duty is in your hand. Result is in my hand. My hand means God. You know, Gita is a book of motivation. Lord Krishna was the first motivational speaker of the world. In today's world, so many professional motivational speakers have come. But the first motivational speaker of the world was Lord Krishna, the God of Hinduism, in lighter vein I am telling. What happened? In battlefield, Arjuna felt demotivated and discouraged. Right now, Krishna started giving motivation so that he came out of demotivation. Right now, he felt energized, motivated to continue the war. That is the theme of Gita. So there in Gita, it has been written, duty is in your hand, result is in the hand of the God. So a person who believes in God and religion, staunch believer of religion, he would think committing suicide is a sinful activity. I did my best, I put my 100% effort in exam, could not succeed because God did not want me to become IAS. If I could not become IAS, I can make hundreds of IAS in this country. Getting my point? But if a person always feels demotivated, what will happen to him? He will not get anything. He may commit suicide. So if you believe in God and religion, that will help you how to come out of frustration, how to come out of negative feeling, how to come out of crisis of life. Got my point? That does not mean, I am telling you, religion has only positive thing. Functional perspective highlights the positive contribution of religion. Here comes Dr. V.R. Ambedkar. Could say, here comes E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar, Periyar of South Indian society. They don't believe in God and religion. They would say God and religion, these are the victims of the God and religion, they are the mechanism of exploitation, that I would discuss. But I am telling you, there are two candidates, both are equally talented, both of them took IAS exam, both of them failed. One believes in God and religion, other does not believe in God and religion. Who believed in God and religion, he will not feel tempted to commit suicide after failure. Other who does not believe in God and religion, but he is talented, after failure, either he would become a revolutionary or he would commit suicide. Okay. First, the person who did not believe in God and religion, it's okay, I am talented. Okay, I could not score good marks. Okay, these people, those who are evaluating my paper, they are the stupid of the highest order. Or fighting with his wife, he entered into the valuation center and started giving marks. That's the reason in tense mood he gave mark. Without seeing the things, that's the reason I could not score good marks. So many, you know, human being is having self-rationalization mechanism. Yes or no? Rationalization mechanism, what is that? You are having, I am also having. A student who wrote the answer could not get good marks. He would say, okay, this I wrote very well. My way of writing English was outstanding, extraordinary. I was having varies, but good vocabulary, but the teacher who was evaluating it could not understand me properly. That's the reason he did not give me good marks. Okay? Yes or no? Some students say like this. Some teacher also say like this, I'm telling you. Teacher taught for 2 hours in the classroom. At the end of the classroom, nobody could understand. He would also adopt self-rationalization mechanism. He would say, intellectually, I'm standing here. All my students are intellectually standing here. So the things I am teaching them, that is passing over their head, that's the reason they are not getting me. So everybody is right. This world is filled with so many people having this type of rationalization mechanism. Getting my point? So telling you the fact, I am connecting it to functional perspective. Religion. With respect to religion, I am explaining you. There are two students. Both of them are equally talented. Both of them took IAS exam. All the 4 attempts are gone. They could not make it. But out of the 2, 1 believe in God, other does not believe in God. Who believes in God, he would think, okay, in spite of my effort, sincere effort, I could not make it. Probably God did not want me to become IAS. Why to worry if I did not become IAS? I can become something else. I can become minister of this country, and the IAS officers are bad masters, good servants. Ministers are good masters. People say like this or not? Am I telling something that people are not saying? People are saying the things that I am telling here. So you see. So in this way, after failure, if a person believes in God, he would not feel demotivated. Instant demotivation would come to every person, whether he believes or disbelieves in God. But a true believer, after some time, because of his belief in God, would be able to come out of that demotivation spirit. Again, he would feel motivated and energized, and somewhere he would become successful. You also might have heard this saying, failure is not the end of the road, it is simply a bend on the road. Failure is a highway to success. National highway to success is failure. So people, those who believe in God and religion, after failure, they will be able to incorporate this type of positive feeling in their heart, because they don't take the sole responsibility on them. They think, in spite of talent, they could not become successful because God did not want them to become so and so. But other candidate who is talented, in spite of talent, could not fail, could not become successful, did not believe in God, after failure, he would feel demotivated. He will develop only negative view related to social life. And if he is highly reactionary, he may join also with the terrorist group. That possibility is there. I am not telling you, it is a certainty. If system could not give you justice, you will not accept the system. You would try to dismantle, deconstruct, destroy the system. That possibility is there. Okay? So in this way, religion is instilling peace in your mind. Whether God is there or not, nobody has seen God. But majority of the people in this world, they believe in God. Yes or no? Do you believe in God or not? Yes or no? I'm sure. Majority of you believe in God. And just the day, 10 days before exam, 5 days before exam, your attachment towards God become more consolidated and crystallized. While you are in trouble, in crisis, you get attached to God. Yes or no? While you are becoming successful in each and every step of the step of your life, I am successful because of my potential, because of my talent, because of my efficiency, ability, aptitude. In spite of talent, aptitude, ability, efficiency, while a person is failing time and again, would say, okay, this is my bad luck. Yes or no? And obviously, 10 days before IAS exam, tension of highest intensity and magnified magnitude comes to your mind. Yes or no? Am I correct or not? So 10 days before exam, you think to go to place of worship like temple, church, mosque, recite certain things from Quran, Bible, Gita. Yes? So nobody knows. Nobody is sure and certain whether God is there or not. But our belief in God helps us how to come out of crisis-ridden life. This is the positive contribution of religion. Okay? Take other example, that is education system. Education system. Or even civil service examination. Ask the question to functional perspective. Functional perspective would say, civil service examination is the topmost examination of this country by which the most talented people of this country are selected to the administrative job. Yes or no? So, civil service examination is a mechanism by which the talented people of the country are given the highest job. This is the positive contribution. So, obviously, you feel that you are talented, that's the reason you started thinking to prepare for it. So, civil service examination is motivating the highly talented people of this country to occupy the topmost administrative positions of the country. Are you clear? In this way, you can take n number of examples from the social life in which you are living in every day. I need not require to expand and elaborate this point. So, in this way, in a brief way, just briefing the things, functional perspective is a way of analyzing social life by which positive contributions of different elements of the society are highlighted by the people. A person having functional perspective would say, okay, that some good IAS officers are there in this country, some good politicians are this country, some good scientists are there in this country, some good social activists are there in this country, some good judges are there in this country. He would say globalization has a positive contribution. He would say caste-based reservation is promoting social justice. He would say before screening any movie, singing that national anthem has some justification in the matter of inducting nationalism among the people of the country. Are you clear or not? So are you able to get it connected to the topics of interview or not? Because all these things that I told you right now, these are the topics of interview. So this is all about functional perspective. Right now, come to conflict perspective. Just the opposite of functional is conflict perspective. Conflict means, do you like conflict? Do you like conflict? Do you like to fight with your friend? Can you avoid conflict with your friend? Do you love conflict? Yes or no? But can you avoid conflict with your friend? Do you really love your best friend always? Don't become jealous, don't become envious of your best friend? Yes or no? Yes or no? If you say no, I can induce that jealousy inside you towards your best friend. I can do it right now. Because social life is like this. The person whom you love the most, he is the person towards whom you develop also jealousy of highest magnitude. You and your brother, your sister, you fight. Excuse me. You, this is a classroom. Don't do it henceforward. Freedom is not free. Whenever liberty is there, responsibility is there. Freedom is not freely available. Yes or no? You have the right of singing a song. This is your right. But you don't have the right of singing a song in the midnight at my door, at my window, or at the door and window of your relatives. This is a demo class of sociology. It means you have the liberty to decide whether to enter into classroom or not. But you have the responsibility to see the teacher should not feel disheartened while he is teaching and you are quitting your seat. Because liberty and responsibility, freedom and right, they go hand in hand with each other. You are quite matured people of the country, and tomorrow, if you become successful, you would become IAS officer, So I don't expect this type of unconscious behavior from you. Yeah, so come back. So what I was telling you is like this conflict. Conflict means the negative aspect. Nobody loves conflict, but conflict is inevitable and is essential part of social life. The friend to whom you love the most, sometimes you also develop jealousy, yes or no? For example, you and your best friend are attending my class. One day you did not come. You asked the class note given by me from your friend. He also helped you a lot. You could not understand something, asked your friend, he attended my class, helped you in the matter of clarifying your doubts. But what happened? Right now, test series program is done. In every test series, you scored a better mark than your friend. Then what would be the feeling of your friend? And after that, some doubt clarification class was organized by the institute. You did not come. Your friend was searching for this opportunity. You asked him the class note. He said, okay, I attended the class, but my class note has been stolen, missing somewhere. Because the person to whom you love the most, there is a possibility that jealousy would also come towards that person. There is a saying, the more closer the relationship is, the more close the relationship is, the more intense the conflict is. The more close the relationship is, or closer the relationship is, more intense the conflict is, yes or no? You and your parents, very close to each other. Always you think in a positive way towards your parents. Don't you think in a negative way towards your parents? You and your brother and sister. Always you think only in positive way towards each other. No, jealousy is there. So while we live in society, we develop positive attitude as well as negative attitude because this is the very nature of social life. Okay? So right now come back to this conflict perspective. In the same way I'm telling you, conflict perspective is another way of looking at the society by which negative contribution of each and every element of society is highlighted. Conflict perspective is another way of looking at the society. Conflict perspective is another way of looking at the society. By highlighting the negative contributions of different elements, Okay, got it? Just opposite of functional perspective is conflict perspective. What is that? Take the same example. First, I took the example of police. To ask the question to functionalist perspective, people, those who believe in functional, called functionalist. To ask the functionalist, what is the contribution of police? He said, you, police is maintaining law and order. Positive contribution. Ask the same thing to a person who believes in conflict perspective, he highlights the negative thing. He would say, police does not maintain law and order. Police promotes partiality in society. How? Citing an example. There is a rich person having money, power, influence in society. Obviously, he got a threat call over phone from a gangster. Give me 1 crore rupees or else your son's life is at stake. A crorepati got a threat call from a gangster, extortion call from a gangster to give this much money. Right now, what did he do? He informed it to the nearby police station over phone. He physically did not visit the police station because he's a person having money, power, influence, connection with ministers of the society. As soon as he informed the officer in charge, inspector in charge of the police station in nearby area, inspector consoled him, sir, don't feel worried. I'm sending some police people to deploy in front of your house. Don't feel worried. Youngster cannot do anything. Okay? Police is maintaining law and order, dispelling insecurity. In the heart of the people, in the mind of the people, police has a positive contribution. Okay? Right now, there is a rickshaw puller. Probably Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana scheme was not introduced. He was not having any bank account. Because 2-3 years ago, Jan Dhan Yojana scheme came, bank account, everybody is having accessibility. By dint of his physical labor, he had collected 5,000 rupees or 10,000 rupees, not having any bank account, kept it in a small container, small box, put below the cot, under the cot. One day night, a thief came, took away it. Next day morning, this rickshaw puller would go to the nearby police station. He is an illiterate, cannot write an FIR, request to the police officer to write an FIR. First of all, police did not respond him properly. Told, okay, you come after 2 hours, I'm busy. After 2 hours, again he came back. He narrated all these things. Right now, police would ask, you are a rickshaw puller, from where did you get 10,000 rupees? Can you give an explanation? Have not you stolen it from somebody else? Getting my point? That possibility is there. I'm not telling you it is sure and certain. Possibility is there. So you see, in case of a rich man having power, money and influence, police is performing the role of a police officer. But in case of a poverty-stricken rickshaw wala, police is performing lesser the role of a policeman, better the role of a tax officer. What is his source of money? Who is police to make an inquiry? Can same police officer ask the influential person, okay, 1 crore rupees threat call you are getting, from where, sir, did you get this 1 crore? There he is a policeman, here he is a tax officer. Are you getting? This is not my personal view. This is not my personal view. I believe in the present system. I'm telling you how different sociologists have given you different dimensions of looking at the society. Are you clear? So, while functionalists say police is a mechanism of society in matter of maintaining law and order, on the other hand, conflict sociologists do say police is promoting, protecting, preserving the interest of the people having money, power and influence. But police is discouraging, demoting, demotivating the pauperized masses. Those who are not having money, they don't have any access to police station. They feel scared to talk to the policeman. Are you clear? Take the other example, religion. I was telling you functional perspective. Religion helps you how to come out of the crisis. While you feel highly demotivated and discouraged, you enter into temple, church and mosque. Do you enter or not? During crisis ridden time, you feel happy to enter into temple. Yes or no? So while you are in trouble, you are in uncertainty, crisis of highest magnitude has come to your life, you feel motivated to enter into temple, church and mosque. Whether God is there or not, that nobody is sure. But your belief in God and religion is helping to come out of crisis-ridden life. Functionalists were telling like this, positive contribution of God, positive contribution of religion. Okay? Right now, in context of conflict perspective, I would tell you the fact, the negative contribution of religion. What is the negative contribution of religion? That could be discussed by conflict perspective. For example, in the name of religion, in traditional Indian society, untouchability was prevailing here. Caste system was prevailing here. Devadasi system was here. Parda system was there. Child marriage was there. All these things were existing because of its linkage with religion. Brahmin Dalit. What happened? Brahmin told traditional Indian society that I came from mouth of God. I'm from mouth. You Dalit came from the foot of Brahma. You are a Shudra. Mouth position is topmost position. Shudra's position is buttermost position. Most position. Getting my point? In this way, in the name of religion, exploitation was done in society. In the name of religion, Dalits were oppressed, inhumanly exploited, harassed in the public place in the name of religion. Even patriarchy, a topic of social issue that I would discuss. All religion you would find patriarchy, you know, patriarchy, rule of the man over the woman is called patriarchy. Authority, decision making power of a man is called patriarchy. What is that? May it be Hinduism, may it be Islamic religion, may it be Christianity, everywhere patriarchy is there. What is that? Man is the product of the nature, man is the product of the society, man is the product of the nature. This is a view given in Vedas. Man is the product of society. Woman is the product of the nature. You know, nature by nature is unpredictable. This is not my personal view. Just like nature by nature is unpredictable, exactly in that way, women by nature are unpredictable. It's written in Vedas. What is right now? Peace, tranquility is prevailing in Hyderabad. A storm of magnified magnitude, like Phailin, like hurricane, tornado, so many names these days geographers are coining. If you give them 10 lakhs rupees, they would also introduce a new type of tornado, new type of cyclone in your name also. Okay, so what is that? Suppose tranquility is prevailing in Hyderabad. Cyclone of terrific magnitude will take place. Everything would be put under destruction, deconstruction, devastation. That possibility is there. So nature by nature is unpredictable. Woman by nature is unpredictable. It's written in Vedas. So man is the nature of society, is the product of society. Society is highly predictable. What is that? Social life is highly predictable. If I praise you, you would feel happy. If I criticize you, you would feel unhappy. This is predictable and unpredictable behavior. Social life is predictable. Man's behavior is predictable. Nature is unpredictable. Woman's behavior is unpredictable. It's written in scriptures of Hinduism. Same thing written in Bible. Same thing written in Quran. Why? Because writers of all these scriptures were basically men. If a man writes his own story, he would create his story of glorification. Yes or no? If you are given the duty of evaluating your paper in UPSC, you would give 250 out of 250, no single mark deduction. So you see this Vedas, a few ladies were there. Srimad Bhagavad Gita, Mahabharata, Ramayana, Quran, Bible, all these things have been written by male. While they wrote their own story, they glorified their position. That's the reason man became product of society, woman become product of nature. Just like nature is unpredictable, woman is unpredictable. What is this? This is a mechanism of exploitation adopted by male members of society just to exploit the woman in the name of God. I'm not telling every writer was having evil intention. That is a separate topic of discussion. There I would make a detailed discussion. Today just I am telling you. So in the name of religion, patriarchy came into existence. Man started ruling over woman, and man said, woman is inferior to me by talent. Who said it? Not me. It's God who said it. You accept it. Suppose a man, if a man says, I personally feel that my wife is inferior to me, my wife would say, no, we are democratic. We are democracy, living in democracy. How do you claim? You are superior, I am inferior. So right now I would say, no, it is God who said this, you accept because you believe in God. So in the name of religion, exploitation came into existence. In the name of religion, caste system came into existence. In the name of religion, Devadasi system came into existence. In the name of religion, Parda system came into existence. In the name of religion, many immoral things also came into existence. This is the negative contribution of religion. Actually, there is a prolific and prominent social scientist. His name is Karl Marx, who is popularly called father of communism. He has given a celebrated expression with respect to negative contribution of religion. You can quote his also view in case of any topic of essay related to religion. Karl Marx says, religion is the heart of the heartless world. You can write it down. His name is Karl Marx. Karl Marx, any topic of essay paper with respect to negative contribution of religion, you can quote Karl Marx. This Marx, who is popularly called father of communism, there he, in a very celebrated expression, he said, religion is the heart of the heartless world. Heart of the heartless world. The spirit of the unspiritual being. Spirit of the unspiritual being. Is it visible to last line or not? Visible? Spirit of the unspiritual being. And religion is the opium of masses. End the inverted comma. Repeating it again. Religion is the heart of the heartless world, the spirit of the unspiritual being, and religion is the opium or opiate of the masses. I'm explaining you. Most of the things in the process of citing example I have explained, but formally I'm explaining. Heart of the heartless world. You know heart? Are you having heart or not? All of you are having heart. But while your friend is angry upon you, he says, you are a heartless person. Means your physically your heart is vanished. Physically heart is existing there. Yes or no? So who is heartless person? Heartless person is an exploiter. A person who exploits innocent people, needy, neglected people, pauperized, poverty-stricken people, he is called heartless person. So heartless person is having a biological heart, but he is lacking emotional heart. Everybody is having a physical heart. Nobody is missing it. So religion is the heart of the heartless world, the world in which immorality prevails, their religion exists. I'm explaining. Brahmin, I don't have any disrespect, negative view towards Brahmins. Okay, just as an academic discussion, I'm discussing the things. Brahmins wanted to exploit the Dalit. They created a story. Okay, Dalit people, you came from the feet of the Brahma, and we came from the mouth of the Brahma. If you respect Brahma, then you respect also the mouth of the Brahma like us. Getting my point? A rich person, an industrialist, exploited the industrial worker. Industrial worker may feel rebellious, but industrialist said, you believe in God. God had made the distinction between rich and poor. If you challenge the rich, you are challenging God. Don't do it. Getting my point? So in this way, man exploited the woman, but man created a story. God made the distinction between you and me. He said that you are less talented, more talented. If you believe in God, then you believe in the words of the God. This is a mechanism of exploitation. So religion is the heart of the heartless world. All of you are clear? Spirit of the unspiritual being. Who are unspiritual being? Unspiritual being you might have heard during, you might have studied, read during your childhood days, Chand Mama. Have you studied or not? Bikram Betal. Might have studied, read, no? Betal, somewhere invisible, there in dense forest, Vikramaditya is moving in the midst of the street in the midnight. Right now he would come and sat on Vikramaditya and would tell, okay, you feel tired, you feel exhausted, right now I'm telling you interesting story so that your tiresome feeling would be relieved. So right now king or emperor feels highly relaxed. Right now story is completed. All of a sudden test series program would be introduced. means without prior notice, test is conducted, take the test, compulsory test. What is the very cruel nature of test? King, you listen the story from me. Right now, I'm putting you the question. If you are having the ability of answering the question, but keeping mum, keeping silence, you would be experiencing beheading. Okay, this how cruel the question is. So devotee is that type of person. Unspiritual beings are like those who always give punishment. So you see, in this country as well as other countries across the world, slavery was prevailing once upon a time. Serfdom was prevailing once upon a time. So those people, those who did this, are they spiritual being or unspiritual being? Spiritual being or unspiritual being? Person who exploits the needy, neglected, poverty-stricken person, he's a spiritual being? He's a cruel. Unspiritual being is a cruel person, cruel being. So all these vicious things, all these vices related to any religion and every religion that persist today, that was persisting long ago, their religion was equated with the spirit of one spiritual being. All of you are clear? Right now come to the next one. Religion is the opiate or opium of the masses. What is opiate or opium? You know, it's a drug, painkiller. What is the role of a painkiller? Suppose I feel here and I consulted a doctor, physician, he gave me a pain, prescribed me a painkiller, I purchased it, took it, right now pain is subsided. Impact of painkiller would be there on my hand only for 5 hours, 6 hours. Painkiller is not solution for pain. It provides temporary belief, temporary relief to pain, but it is not curing the disease. So painkiller is a temporary solution, it's not a permanent solution. So Karl Marx says, religion is a temporary solution to people's problem. What is that? There is a poverty-stricken person, in spite of his sweat of brows, is not able to provide 2 square meals to his children. His children are having malnourishment, marginalization. Right now entered into temple, participated in Hari Kirtan, raising the hands towards the sky, participated in it. Forgot the pains, the suffering of the family for 2 hours, 3 hours, yes or no? Because he cannot live in temple, church and mosque forever. As soon as he is inside the religious institution and its premises, he does not feel the problem of the family. Coming out of the premises of the temple, again the problems are there with him. Getting my point? So in this way, Karl Marx said, he was very much justified to some extent because perspective means no. Not 100 people would agree. So, religion is heart of the heartless world, is the spirit of the unspiritual being, is the opiate of the masses. Are you clear? So, one group of people are highlighting positive contribution of religion, they are functionalists. Other group are highlighting negative contribution, they are conflict sociologists. In fact, religion has both positive and negative contribution. And right now, I'm connecting it to globalization. Functional perspective will highlight the positive contribution of globalization. For example, today you wanted to purchase some fruits, you entered into the nearby shopping mall, inside the shopping mall you found a fruit stall where fruits of different varieties grown in different parts of this world have been arranged properly. Some fruits, those who have been imported from Switzerland, like apples of Switzerland, apple of Europe, and America have been kept also there in fruit stall. These apples are having very glowing appearance. Some fluorescent colored stickers have been pasted on it, on its surface. You felt captivated. This shining appearance captivated your imagination. You felt tempted to purchase it. 30 years ago, while your father wanted to purchase the fruits of America in Hyderabad city, fruits grown in Switzerland, in Hyderabad city, it was not so easily available. Right now, it is available for you. So globalization has gifted you with enormous opportunity. This is positive aspect of globalization. This is functional perspective. But I want to take you back to conflict perspective. If every customer wants to purchase the fruits having shining, glowing appearance, fluorescent color stickers have been pasted on its surface, then what would happen to the indigenous fruit growers? Our people in Kashmir are also growing apple. If all customers would prefer to purchase fruits imported from America, Switzerland, other parts of the world, the livelihood of the people growing fruits, different fruits in this country, would be put at stake. So what is opportunity for one group of people that is putting the livelihood at stake for another group of people? So positive aspect of globalization, that will be highlighted by functional perspective. Negative aspect of globalization, that will be highlighted by conflict perspective. Getting my point? I think time is already exceeded. So just I intended to tell you how to decide your obstacle. And today, just I gave you different dimensions of deciding the optional. And if you opt sociology, the rest of the things would be taught by me. Okay. So thank you a lot. And thank you for listening me attentively. Rest in the next class, that would be started, that would sociology would be formally started from the next class, that is on 17th. Thank you a lot.